Test, test. Is it on? Okay. Hello. Today I'm going to talk about Ox and AngularJS. The talk slot is 50 minutes. The talk length is actually more than 40 minutes, so I'm probably going to end up a little bit earlier, or we can have more discussions and questions. My name is Thomas Klausner, or Tom, just not a Perl hacker. I'm from Vienna, Austria, Vienna PM. I'm also from Bicycle PM, which you probably know already. Just promoting it every time. We also have the Austrian Perl workshop coming up on 10th to 13th October in Salzburg. Larry Wall will probably come if his health allows it. Jonathan Worthington, Tim Bunz, Nick Clark. So it's going to be a nice small hackathon conference thing. So if you're near Salzburg, drop by. Yeah. Most of my time I work for that company, a very small company in Vienna. Most of the code I've written was developed by and for them, and we're hiring, so if you're interested, ask me. Okay, now to the proper talk, Ox and Angular. Super heroic and hardworking open source frameworks for back and front end. That's the respective self descriptions of those frameworks. I'll just give you a quick overview of Ox. So it's of course on CPAN. It's written by those guys, Stephen Little, Jesse Lewis, basically Infinite Interactive, so they're sort of smart, they did moves and stuff like that. The hardest working two letters in Perl, that's the tagline, I like it very much. It's basically based on breadboard, pathroot, and PSGI. I assume everybody knows what PSGI is, if not, there are some talks on it later. Pathroot is a routing class that maps URLs to code, and breadboard is a very cool dependency injection framework. Sort of complex and very hard to get into, but if you use it a little bit, it's very cool and very interesting. Yeah, I've got another talk on it, not at this conference, and it's a big topic, so I'm just going to touch it a little bit, but check it out anyway. The philosophy behind Ox is that the building blocks of your web application should just click together without the overhead of an additional plugin system or glue layer. So it's not like, for example, it's not a monolithic thing like basically Catalyst, for example, which is a web framework, and you add code and code and code, and then in the end you have, or at least I found it rather hard to use lots of parts of those code of this code and the configuration in other contexts. And I think that every web application, or every application, is like maybe 50% web, and the rest is cron jobs, scripts, stuff, another thing. And Ox, because it's based on breadboard, makes it very easy to reuse all of those components you have in a lot of different contexts. Okay, that's a little bit far down, sorry. It's mostly based on something called dependency injection, which I'll go into a little bit, and it's also very testable. In the meantime, Catalyst applications, for example, you can test them, but when Catalyst came out, testing Catalyst applications, you know, required to fire up an actual web server and talk to the web server. Now we have Plug, it's a lot easier, of course, but still, it's even easier with that. Okay, AngularJS, available there. It's basically from Google, I think, or at least they're maintaining it. It's a super heroic JavaScript framework, also based heavily on dependency injection. They also, one of their design targets is to be testable, which is sort of weird for JavaScript, but in the meantime, it's actually doable. The one big downside of AngularJS, it's not working for clients without JavaScript. It's not degrading. So if you're... There are some hacks around it, so we can make it work without with clients without JavaScript. But if you're hit by a search engine, the search engine just sees some garbage HTML and no content at all, for example. Dependency injection. It's an easy concept. Define all the things your classes need, the dependencies, outside of the class. And then pass them to the class when you initiate or construct an object, so inject them into it. I think it's a very simple concept hidden behind very complex words. So the software architects can feel more important. Yeah. Stuff like idempotent and orthogonal, it's like totally simple as soon as you understand it, but they hide it behind these complex things so they get the higher paychecks, or I don't know, whatever. So it's very simple. So instead of having something like that, where you have a class that does something and it needs a time travel thing, so inside the method, you initiate a time traveler and do something with the time traveler. Yeah. that's regular code, it works, but it's not dependency injection. Dependency injection looks something like that. You use moves, for example, you have an attribute, and then inside the method you just access the dependency and do something with it. And outside of your class, you initiate whatever thing you need and pass it to the object during initiation of the object, and then run it. Okay, so that's dependency injection. We're doing that for ages, and then a few years ago somebody came up with a cool name and everybody got confused. At least I got confused. I was like, what's that? And then, well, I'm doing that for, you know, whatever. So the nice thing is, of course, you can use another implementation. So if you don't want to use a flux compensator by the TARDIS, you can just pop in another time traveling device, as long as they are, you know, use the same interface using duct typing or something like that. And if you have that, then it's even easier during testing to pop in something else, a mock compensator, because, you know, you don't want to get the plutonium all the time to do the actual time traveling, so you can just fake the interface and do your tests. Okay, so that was about dependency injection. Now, the mem page of aux, that's basically just the mem page, what's on in there. So you have a package, you use aux. Aux is a subclass of breadboard, so if you do that, then all of this is also automatically a breadboard, which is not very important. In the moment, you have some dependencies, some things you need to do, for example, a controller that does something, or you have models that access the data. What you have here is you have stuff like a life cycle, something that breadboard also provides. So you can say this object is a singleton, so in the whole life cycle of that process, you only want to initiate that object once. This thing here is something called infer, which tells breadboard to figure out the dependencies of that thing by introspecting that class, looking at its attributes using moves, figure out what it needs, and then using breadboard to actually initiate those classes and pass them on to the whatever class that is. Those names are just, I came up with that, you don't have to name them. It also doesn't have to be model view control, it can be anything. Then you define your routes using path router, where you say, okay, if the user accesses one of those URLs, call that thing. So that's the class and that's the method in the class. What you can also do, like here, you can define some parameters, you can do some type checking. So if you call set with something that is an integer, that thing here is called. But if you call set with a text, it won't even call the controller. So you can do that just like very out in the application. So that's the model I'm using. That's basically just a quick moves thing using the moves trait counter, which implements a counter. So you get increment, decrement, reset, and set things. That's just plain moves. Here's the controller. I think I have, yeah. So that's a class. It uses moves, that's it. Doesn't inherit of everything. It's not use base, catalyst, controller, something. It's just a class. Doesn't care about if it's used in aux or whatever. It has a dependency. It uses the counter model. It's required. So when breadboard initiates that thing, it goes in here, says, give me the attributes. Oh, I need an MyApp model. It's required. So I look up in breadboard, how do I get that? Set it up, pass it in. And then you have some methods that do stuff. It's just like, you know, all of those, they just get one thing here, self, because they don't do anything. Most of the time, it looks like that. So you get as first argument self, which is placed into the class. You get the request, which is a web request. We'll go into that in a minute. And any additional stuff you passed into the path. You know, you remember set has an argument, a number. So that argument will be in here. And then you can do whatever you want in the controller. So that's going to be in there. You can start it. This aux class already is a PSGI application. No need to initiate and use for PSGI or something. Just run it. It's a very boring live demo. So you can go to increment here. Do you see it? No, sorry. And the count is incremented, and you can decrement it, and yeah. Oh. Sorry. You can set it to 42.
you cannot set it to foo. You can reset. So that's, it works. That was the talk.
So that was the Angular man page. We'll come to it a little bit later. Now that was the Ogg man page. Now to the Angular man page. That's again just a code snippet I've taken from the website. I'm not really a JavaScript guy, so the JavaScript part is going to be sketchy. but well, so the point is, you have Angular adds some special things to your HTML like this. You of course have to load the Angular JavaScript itself. And then you get stuff like that, ng model, or you get stuff like this, templates inside your HTML. And that's the reason why when you view this HTML without having JavaScript enabled, you just see crap. But if you have JavaScript enabled, Angular sort of, I don't know, passes the HTML and does some magic things, use it with those ng app and ng whatever thing is. So that's not a live demo. You can, we've seen it already in one or two talks earlier. One of the key things of Angular is that the live update of the DOM. So you can write something in here, and it's, sorry, I cannot hit enter because that goes to the next slide. So you can enter something in here and it's automatically updated again. Sorry. Automatically updated on the slides. Yeah, or on your website. So, yeah, so that was, here we have the model your name. It's in, that just says enter your name here. And then as soon as you type something in here, those are related. So whatever is in this input type thing goes into that HTML output thing. That's another a little bit more complex example, again from the man page. That's the source code. It's not very long. Okay, yeah. One thing here that's new is, of course, in the end, you don't want to, you actually want to write your own application using Angular. So you do that, put it in some external JavaScript files which get loaded, and you use other tools like Grunt or whatever to install all of the dependencies. It's getting ugly there. Anyway, so that's the JavaScript thing. Again, go into it a little bit later. That's the render thing of this. This is a sort small of to-do list thingy where you can add stuff here. The typing. Okay. Ah, okay. So that's the official hello world. Okay.
There's a comparison page of over 30 frameworks which all do this kind of applications. The hello world.
Okay. So you can add some stuff. It gets added to this list. Don't hit enter. Okay. Now it's gone because it's not. There's no state. You can do stuff and whatever. So it's a very small application, and as you've seen, it's not a lot of code. Of course, it's completely stateless now. That's very interesting. So yeah. Again, you have this ng controller thingy which maps to some class inside your Angular application. You have a lot of those things. Ng click, so if you click on that thing, that method is called in your JavaScript code. You can do repeats, so you can loop over all of the to-dos. So take each one of those things, put it in here, and then write some stuff in here. So you have loop controls and a lot of stuff. Again, here's another, here's a form. And if you enter something into the form and submit it, that thing is called, so you can call your JavaScript stuff. That's the controller again. So it starts setting up the default to-dos. It's just an array of text thingies. That's the function to add something. You just push whatever you got onto the list, show the remaining things. It's basically just giving the counter. It's, you know, when I first encountered JavaScript in the end of the 90s, it was horrible and ugly, and every other line was if user agent equals that to this, if user equal agents equal that to that. And I find this very nice actually to work with. So it looks pearlish enough for me to get my head around it. Okay, so now a real life example, something you're working on, that's that thing here, just, oops, still incrementing. So it's some sort of admin interface thingy where you can get a list of stuff, then you can view that thing and move. Do you see it? Oh, shit. Sorry. Right, maybe I'll do it on the full screen mode again. Yeah, so you have some navigation in here. And the point, of course, is that it's some sort of everything is done using REST APIs thing. So the Angular code calls your backend. The really nice, the thing I like most about it is that I don't have to write any HTML anymore. I didn't write a single piece of HTML in the last few months since we switched to that thing, which I like a lot because I rather write code than HTML. And the boring HTML generation stuff is now outsourced to the front end guys. So, and apparently they like it. Well, I don't know. So what's happening here is that, as you see down here, when we get the page, we do an HTTP request and get some JSON back. And if you view one of those things, there's another HTTP request to get the detailed information of that thing here. And if you page through the set of things, it only gets the next detailed view of this page, and it remembers the list in the client. Yeah, so the set of those when I get to that thing and get the list, it fetches 10 items, stores them basically in the client side in the memory, and then when you iterate through the list, it's not getting the list all the time. It's just getting it from JavaScript, and only when it's done with that list, it goes to the server again, fetches the next 10 things, and goes through that. So that's quite nice, actually. That's just a test application thing, so it's horribly localized and full of typos and shit. And it's also not real data, that's just random stuff. Here you can, it's basically some sort of admin interface where people can publish stuff. So here you can say, no, I don't want that, so you eject it, and then you type in it's crap, and save that. And now you will set an HTTP request to the server, setting state of that thing to crap, and reject it, and move to the next thing. Or you can accept it and do stuff like that. Oops. So that's that's basically the aux controller doing all of that. Again, it's just basic class. That thing is a helper class that sets some sort of global values. For example, in the user interface, you've seen. Oh, but sorry. That's also one very nice feature of Angular that I forgot to show you. They have a lot of filters in their core language, so you can have this list of things here. And now, if I type in here, it automatically does a live update on the DOM and filtering all. Showing only the elements that match whatever query I select. And that's done, of course, only in the front end and as you type. Hope so. Yeah. And you can, of course, you can also filter on some select boxes or on some status and whatever. And that's really rather easy to implement.
You on your server and just shove JSON.
Well, that thing is, in the end, we just give it a big chunk of JSON, and the Angular front end makes some data structure out of it. I'm going to show it to you later. And then when you filter, you just, the front end goes through the data structure and filters and stuff like that. Of course, complicated queries, you have to, again, go to the back end to get new data or fresh data and stuff like that. This thing here is basically a definition of what kind of types do we have, what kind of status do we have, and stuff like that. So the JavaScript front end doesn't have to know any of those things. It gets all the information from the back end. So if you add a new type, we just add it to the back end, and the front end, just there's a new thing in the select box. There's a campaign model, which is something that's just okay, whatever, that goes to the database or to some data stores and fetches the data. It's irrelevant for that talk at the moment. So here's the root thing, which returns the list. It does some parameter parsing. Is there an offset and some rows? So do you want, are you on the 20th page or something like that? and then goes to the campaign model and says, please give me whatever, the next set of thing. What's returned here is some sort of data structure. And this thing here, I'll go into that in a minute, just returns a new JSON response. So it takes the data structure, converts it to JSON, sends it out. Okay, what's that here? You get the parameters, you of course, get via $rec. So if you have regular HTTP parameters, you can access them in Moose using rec param, just like in Catalyst or in any other application. That's what I was going about. And then return some JSON. So Ox uses something called web request and web response for handling PSGI requests and responses. Those are standard modules. They're not tied to any particular implementation. They're just an abstract request and an abstract response. It's very easy to add functionality to those via subclassing. Actually, Ox uses a custom subclass of the web request called Ox request, which adds a few methods. And it is recommended practice that you add your own subclass and adding all of the stuff you need all the time to those, or maybe upload it to CPAN, which we are probably going to do soonish. So in that project, we have our own subclass, which looks like this. I'm just going to show you a few things. It's, again, Moose controller, the extending Ox request, and the new JSON response, which I was using earlier, just gets some data and then returns a PSGI response with some headers, set the correct content type, the status, and the content in that case is just encoded data as JSON. Very simple, but it's very nice because now it's inside my controllers, I just say return JSON data, data structure, and I'm done with it. Of course, you can do that in any application framework. In Catalyst, you would set up a JSON view and forward to the JSON view. It's basically the same. So that's another thing that's getting one thing. So we get the UID of the thing, go to the model, grab the thing, get back some data structure, and pass it on. So that's very nice. I mean, okay, those controllers lack stuff like currently logging or authentication, but yeah, that's how controllers should look like, yeah, empty. Because all of the complicated stuff should happen in your model, which is easier to even easier to test than Catalyst, and you can use it. I can use that thing in a cron job easily. Yeah, what about that thing here? We're using something called Ox Root Builder REST. I did it because we needed that, and it wasn't available in Ox back then. So in your roots, you can do something like rest.campaign something. And then if you do a get request, it gets to item_get. But if you do a post request, it goes to __put. Basically the same way that Catalyst, Action, REST, or whatever. Yeah, I just reused it, stole it, or was inspired by that. So you can use your HTTP verbs to, you know, dispatch on different API endpoints or resources or whatever the name, correct name is. Yeah, that thing, by the way, is the one that updates the status and sets it from rejected or to something like whatever. So that thing here, for example, is another thing we put into web request. I think I've got it in here. Yeah. Which basically just takes the HTTP request, looks into the payload of the HTTP request, because the JSON was posted or put it. It's not in the parameters. It's in the body of the HTTP message. So get that out of it, check if it's JSON encoded, decode the JSON into a Perl data structure, and then just give it back the data structure. So all of that stuff is moved out of the way. Try catch to figure out if there's a thing. If there was an error, we can have this other thing called new JSON error, which just returns a nice error message. And then we have middlewares that say, oh, the user agent is JSON, then return just a JSON. And if it's a human, or if it doesn't have accept application JSON in the headers, we make a nice error message and return that. So the human sees some proper stuff with the logos and whatever. As I just said. Okay, let's just return the thing. I also saw that's getting the JSON of the content, that's the thing. Yeah, that's the globals. Just go somewhere, get that's the endpoint making the globals available to the JavaScript application, so it's just some wrapper around some other things. So an Ox controller is just a plain class with some simple methods. It's very easy to test. especially since you can initiate web request objects very easily by hand. It's not like, I mean, I don't know if any of you ever did mod Perl stuff. Who did mod Perl? Yeah. You know, faking HTTP Apache request things and trying to unit test those was horrible.
Why back then nobody tested anything?
Well, I did some tests, but I had to use www mechanize and stuff like that, which sort of worked, but was really horrible. Okay, now the Angular controller, a lot of code, apparently, because this font size is so small. So I like it because I don't have to write it, and I don't have to generate any HTML. And even if you look at that code, if you had to generate all the HTML using template toolkit or templating systems, it would be even more code probably in the templating mixed with HTML, and then you need to add classes. And I just hate HTML. Disgusting. And apparently it's easier to get front-end developers because apparently JavaScript is the new hot shit and everybody's doing JavaScript and Node.js, so it seems to be easier to get front-end people to do the front-end stuff and have a few back-end guys or girls do the back-end stuff instead of wasting my time and my saneness by having write me templates or HTML. So I'm only a beginner using AngularJS, so there might be a lot of crap in that thing. And actually, I didn't write that code, somebody else wrote it. I've just, you know, we talked about it, and I think I extended a little bit. Yeah. So that's the dependency injection part in Angular. So you set up your controller, you have some application thing, some controller, and then you have a list of stuff that you need. You need a scope, some parameters, the web service, whatever. You just write it in there. You have to write it twice for some reasons that apparently have to do with uglifying and minifying the code. And apparently there are some ways around it, but they may not be very nice. Anyway, yeah, it's just some boilerplate code, but it's still worth it. So inside the controller, that's some sort of setup code where you say, okay, those are my, this is the list of all the campaigns, this is the current campaign, the count, the types and the status, and some the active filters. Then just the first time it is initiated, I call some web service to get these global values, like the list of what kind of things do we have and what are the available status things, and put those into these scopes. If it's not working, we can put out an error. So this is using something like an end service or a component called web service, which is injected in here, and again written by the JavaScript guys. Looks like that. And what it basically does is it's for one thing, it's handling some sort of the base URL thing, which is sometimes a problem. So because we only have regular relative links, but maybe they're mounted under some strange thing. So this is some sort of global value which tells the front end where the back end actually is. Yeah, and then it does just HTTP requests and wraps that into some stuff. It's using deferred promises, which are the new hot shit apparently. I think there is a talk on futures later, which is basically promises in Perl for doing async.
No, it's futures, and promises are something like futures, but a bit different. And the promises in Perl are by Stephen Little.
Okay.
And the futures in Perl are by Leon.
Okay, thanks. Yep. So we have futures and promises.
Yes.
And they're a little bit different, and there are some talks on it later, so I recommend to check them out, because it's really quite nice to have for async stuff and callback. So to escape callback hell, basically, that's what they're about. You know, where you have callback, deep down. Yeah. Well, but in my control, I don't actually have to care about that because that's, again, encapsulated by some other class. So, yeah, encapsulation. So that thing is, that's get called, this method is called, the method in JavaScript, this is called when you hit the next button in the user interface. No, that's node next, sorry, that's, you add a node and then go to the next thing, so it gets a status, stores the status, shows the box. That's showing the node when you hit the thing, which is that thing here. Yeah, you have the button node next stalled, and then you can get the parameter passed into your JavaScript thing. I already showed you that. I'm not going to do it again. And that's the thing that's actually sending now the status to the backend. I don't know why half of the stuff is, I can do that. too much indentation. So that's a method that gets the UID, the actual status, and the nodes. It calls the web service to make a put request, going to that URL and putting the status and the node. So we can store it in whatever storage thing we're using at the moment. And then, so if this works, update the status in the user interface and go to the next campaign. Update the slide. Yeah, so the admin person can just say, reject, reject, accept, accept, reject, accept, and doesn't have to go to the list all the time. Campaign iterator, that's some ugly shit. I'm just skipping that. Sorry. Yeah, so actually showing the campaign, the Angular uses plain HTML files with some sort of templating thing in it to show the stuff.
Do you serve them
statically? No. They're sort of served through Angular, I think. Okay. Yeah, served static? Yeah. Okay, I think Angular fetches it and then injects the actually content. I don't actually know how the internals work. Anybody have an idea?
Angular parse. Yeah, parse.
Yeah. Okay.
You serve this static as a static
yes.
Page.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. That's the problem. If Angular is not activated, then you'd see that, yeah, like the garbage part. Yes, okay. Okay. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, Angular also has some routing information, which tells if so. All of the URLs basically look like backend hash sign, and then an Angular route. And you map those routes to some other part in the application, and then you can do a lot of funky stuff in, like, if you're calling that part of the application, you have to be authenticated or call stuff before. But as I said, I'm not a JavaScript guy, sorry. yeah, but there's a very good documentation of Angular on their website, and the tutorial you can work through. So if you're actually interested in the front-end side, take a look at that. Sorry, I'm probably not the best person to teach that. Just some sort of overview for back-end persons. So the wrap-up of the first part, Ox is a very nice and decoupled framework for backends. It's really very nice. Angular is a very nice and decoupled framework for front-ends. Maybe there are newer, shinier front-ends in the moment because JavaScript frameworks replicate like triples. But Angular is quite stable, and it's got a good infrastructure for extending it, and it also works quite well with other stuff, so I think it's going to stay for some time. Okay, now the bonus slides, which I expected. 5 minutes? Okay. There's a REST API abusing HTML form handler, testing and testing aux. Those are the bonus slide things. So HTML form handler, do you know it? Who knows it? Okay, a very short introduction. It's a very big and cool thing for handling forks. Some of the parts are a little bit complex to learn, especially if you want to have your custom renderers and stuff like that, so you can generate your own custom HTML. We used it for ages in a lot of traditional web pages, you know, which just spew out HTML. But recently we did some resty stuff, but we still need to have some sort of forms. Yeah, because the user still enters some data, and we have to validate that. But the forms are generated in the JavaScript frontend, and the backend just gets the JSON. So we still need to do input validation, we still need to parameter checking and updating the database and a lot of other stuff, and we already know HTML form handler, and it's quite good at that.
Tom, yep. Sorry, I was wrong, 15 minutes.
Okay, 15 minutes, okay. Yeah, that's what my thing is saying, so okay, whatever. It's probably not going to take 15 more minutes, so you can relax. So we took HTML form handler and jammed it into a REST API HTML-less environment, and it worked quite well. So this is a basic HTML form handler class. For those who don't know it, you have a class, you use form handler and that thing. Okay, ignore that for now. You can define some basic forms things like here, for example, that's post the name of the method. I want to use Bootstrap 3 as a wrapper. So if I render that form as HTML, it's rendered using Bootstrap 3. That's also very nice. or you can use Bootstrap 2, or you can use the default, or you can also render it by yourself. And then you can define the fields of the form using some types, they're required or not, placeholders. It's really very powerful, and you can, I didn't find a form yet that I couldn't implement using HTML form handler. And I've seen some weird forms. Okay, I just said that. I can turn it bigger, and I also such that. So here's how I use it. In some plain old thing, you just initiate the form and then call render on it, and you get the empty form. And if you want to check if it's submitted, it's a little bit more complicated. I'll show it in a minute. So this would return a big string of HTML, which turns out to be a form. So what we are doing is we are initiating the form and calling this method, which is not part of HTML form handler. Earlier you've seen that we're using this role here. This role implements that that thing. So here it is. It's a moose role using HTTP throttle factory, log any, whatever, that's just stuff. So here's the for Angular method, which basically says, are there errors, then return the error thing. If there are no errors, then grab all of the fields of the form that are currently active, because sorted fields returns the list, the sorted list of fields that are in the form and active. Those are all the fields. Skip the unactive fields, convert each field into something, push it in the data structure, and return some data structure, which then is converted to JSON and sent to the front end. The convert field method looks something like this. It takes the internal values of the form, like name, type, whatever, and pushes it into a big array, a hash, yeah, blah, 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 and then returns the data structure. So that was, okay, I'll show you later. Another thing that's the updating thing, the post. So you post somewhere, that's apparently some sort of forgot password thing, you know, where you enter your email address and then get an email with a password link. Ignore that thing. So we have this thing, form put rec, which returns true. So if that worked, apparently the form was okay, and we can continue figuring out if the user exists and set up the email, you know, get the key and send it. It's just business logic. And if it's not, then return an error handler. So this is the put method in our role, which implements it. It gets the decoded JSON content. It calls self process, which is what you do in form handler to process the form, which does checks if all of the required fields are there, if the types match, if everything, if the data the user submitted is correct. And only if it is correct, this thing will return true and you go in here. In this case, we just return one because we want to let the controller later do whatever he wants to do. And if it's not, then we return undef and have some error handling. The nice thing, of course, is we can do some logging in here and general more stuff. That the live code is a bit more complex than that. So the live demo for that is something like this. So can you read that? Sort of. Okay, I'm just using curl to call the forgot password start controller.
Bigger is better if you can make it bigger.
I think that's the hugest I can go. I mean, I can make the thing bigger, but I don't think that
the right-click menu here?
Yeah, but it's already set to huge. Can I get it even bigger?
No, okay. Not in this term.
Okay. Yeah, but it's not that important. I mean, you don't need the details. So I call curl, use curl to get the drilling and get back the definition of the form. So the JSON frontend, or the Angular frontend, when it wants to render the form, just calls that and gets the form definition back. So we don't have to store the actual form definition in the frontend. Everything is handled by the backend, and the frontend just renders it. It has some code to convert that thing into some HTML, which I don't care about because I don't like it. So then we can make a, sorry. Like that. Then I can make another request using post to the same URL, accept the application JSON and some data, some JSON payload. I'm sending foo and bar, which of course are not, the form doesn't care about them, so it returns, no, sorry, the field ident is required, and it's an error. So the front end can return to the user message showing that. So I add an ident field here. I still cannot type. Sorry. Yeah. So I'm posting the ident thing, but I'm sending bar, which is not an email address. So HTML form handler has defined the field as email. So it does validation of the email field, blah, 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 doesn't work. So gives me an error and an error message. The error message can be localized. HTML form handler handles the localization. Of course, you could also handle localization in the front end, whatever you want. For you to decide. Okay, so I do an email address. And now it works, but now I get a message from the underlying business logic, which says I don't know that user, so I cannot set up and cannot send out the password request for it. I actually don't have any users in the database, so I cannot show you what happens when it works, because I just did it in the morning and I didn't fix the database. But if it worked, it would just say message okay, and said something like I will send an email to the user in 5 minutes or in timestamp. So not only do I like it a lot because it's very easy to write the backend code, it's also easier to, when developing the stuff and you're not actually writing a test or not writing the test yet because the API is not finished and you're working on it, to have stuff like that in your command line and just go arrow up, enter, arrow up, enter, arrow up, enter, instead of having to fill out this big form with 10 fields all the time. Of course, you could use some web automation front end things to do that, but it's so much setup. I like this. This system more. Okay, one more thing, HTML form handler works perfectly with DBAX class. There's something called HTML form handler model DBIC, where you can just link your form handler and your DBIC classes together, and it does updates automatically, even following relations and stuff like that. It's very nice. We wrote some wrappers for that. I'm not going to show you, but we have like a thing where you can just post a JSON document to an endpoint, and it will automatically update the database. In the controller, it's just one line of code. And the wrapper is also like that much. So anyway. So testing aux, it's the other bonus thing. I've shown a little bit of that in my other talk, Code I'm Proud Of, but that's some different thing. As I said, aux controller is just a simple class, not bound to Plague or any web server. An action is just a method, getting an instance of the class, and a web request object. That's it. And maybe some other parameters which you pass on. So to test the controller action, you actually just need to initiate an instance and create a web request, and then call the method. So some hand waving, unfortunately, because I'll just show you one of the test things. So some of the stuff is in, the interesting stuff is in here, or basically especially in here. That's something I was using for like a year. I'm probably going to refactor it now because I learned it a lot in the last year. So anyway, as I said, all of that is breadboard. So this thing here initiates that controller using breadboard to figure out what are the dependencies of that controller, and use breadboard again to figure out the database connection, where are the templates, all of that stuff. That's all done in here using breadboard. It's really not that much code. I just don't show it at the moment. And it's really very nice because, as I showed in my other talk, you can then in the breadboard say, oh, I'm running tests. So instead of doing an template toolkit, I just return a I'm just returning some crappy mock render or whatever. That's just setting up a fixture for a user, so I have that user in a database. What we are using for testing, by the way, which you don't see in here because it's hidden in there, is we have a test database, which is basically empty or maybe has some very few core things. And then in each test, we just start a transaction, do all the tests, and at the end, roll back. So the test database is always empty, but we can use everything we want. Of course, we're using Postgres, which has nested transactions and stuff like that.
You know that you can test Postgres Perl-style directly.
I can test what?
You can test Postgres Perl-style directly.
Yes, I'm testing the Perl code, not the Postgres.
Okay.
Yeah, so, I could, So this is one of those tests. This thing here sets up a web request. It's some helper method. And then I just call the some controller. Also, I call the controller, I want to call that method with that request, and then I get some stuff back. Sorry? Okay. So you get back a data structure, which basically is, in that thing, it's whatever that method returned. That method happens to return a call to self-render, which should return HTML code. That's another project that's not as resty. That's still returning some HTML part. But using breadboard, we replace the template toolkit renderer with a fake renderer that just returns that data structure. Sorry, so in the test, I can just say, okay, the first argument of whatever that thing returns should be the template, and the second argument is the page title apparently, and then there is a there's the form in here, so I can actually test the form handler object itself for stuff. I don't have to scrape the HTML and do regex and that stuff. That's disgusting. So now here I again use this thing to set up a web request using some parameters. That thing is maybe 20 or 30 lines of code, basically a lot of helper stuff. So if there is a set, I can in here fake session IDs and logged in users or whatever and make different kinds of requests and then just call the thing and check some stuff without using a web server or PSGI or anything. It's just really call a method and check that it returns the correct thing. Well, it's the same again. Yeah, okay. So that's it. Any questions? Yeah, okay.
Did you come up with the forward password code on your own, or did you reuse something existing?
With what? The password code?
The forward password code?
Do you mean the actual business implementation of setting up
the
password thing?
Right.
No, that's unfortunately custom written. Is there anything that we could that's reusable?
No.
Okay.
I just noticed that one guy wrote something for Dancer, but I didn't check it out.
Okay. So, well, unfortunately, all of this boring, you know, user registration, verification key, password setting, and all of that stuff, there is no proper, I mean, I'm not sure if it's actually possible to have a generic framework for that, because it's so business dependent on whatever you want. So I'm not sure if it's possible to have an actually usable framework that's not as general as just using DBAX class or something to set up the database.
Thanks.
Okay. What we are doing, which I didn't show you in here, is we have to actually work against that problem, because we are now having a lot of smaller applications, is we set up an OAuth 2 server and moved all of the password reminder verification stuff into the OAuth 2 application. And now our, at least the applications that work with that thing, just talk to that OAuth 2 server. So we don't have to use it all the time. Any more questions?
I have one question, which is, are your slides online, or will they shortly be?
The slides are online already, but slightly older version without the bonus slides, or different bonus slides, but I will update them and put those slides online too. And they're on my website, and I'll just tweet it. And I think they may be already linked from ACT.
They're not yet.
They're not yet.
But they will be
soon. Okay,
great.
Soon. Okay.
One more question we've got time for, if anyone. So thank you very much, Tom.
Thanks.
Great talk.
Okay.